Starting from the inside of the ninth row, Johnny Rutherford stormed up through the pack to take the lead in the 1974 Indianapolis 500. And as dark clouds threatened rain, Rutherford took the checkered flag to win at Indy for the first time. It would not be the last time for the Texan they call Lone Star AR. Hello, I'm Paul Page. Johnny Rutherford's first Indianapolis win was a true victory for perseverance. Surviving through 11 years of near misses, painful injuries, and mechanical misfortune, he finally made it to the top. Adding wins in 1976 and in 1980, Johnny Rutherford established himself as a true legend at the Indy 500, a race for heroes. Johnny Rutherford's road to success at Indy comes from a deeply rooted love for auto racing.
The first time, I can remember it like it was yesterday, and it's been some time ago, but I can remember Dad taking us out to the track, to the fairgrounds track in Tulsa, and they had some midgets warming up on the track, out doing a little practice just at dusk. And I saw these brightly colored little Easter eggs running around the racetrack, and I, for a nine-year-old, you know, at that particular period, which was probably 1947, I guess, or 46, 47, I just lit up and tilt. You know.
As a teenager in Fort Worth, Texas, Johnny's association with a local hot rod club helped get his driving career underway.
During this period in the hot rod club, found out about the racing in Dallas and went over there on a Friday night, and it started all over again. You know, I thought, wow, I'm old enough now, I can drive one of these things. And so I immediately hawked everything I had virtually and found an old Chevrolet, 32 Chevrolet coupe, that had been a race car at one time, and started in with the help of the club members in the Hot Rod Club and built my first race car.
His goal was to race at Indy, and in 1960, Johnny and fellow Texan Jim McElreath went north to race the Midwestern Sprint Circuit.
I just couldn't ask for a better training or a better place to have learned the trade of auto racing and competition. And it was something I'll always remember and cherish. A lot of good times, a lot of bad times. But nonetheless, it got me my opportunity eventually to run at Indianapolis.
That same year, Rutherford witnessed his first Indianapolis 500. It was an impressive one, with Roger Ward and Jim Rathman staging a classic two-car duel for the last 250 miles. Rathman won the battle.
Johnny Rutherford is a gentleman's gentleman. I mean, he's a class guy. He's a good racer. He's everything. He's got everything going for me. He should have been in the movies.
When he first came to the Speedway, I guess my thoughts on him were that he was going to be the next superstar. It took a long, long time for him to develop into that status.
McElreath made it to Indy in 1962, winning Rookie of the Year honors. And the next year, Johnny Rutherford made his Indianapolis debut. It was a rude awakening.
When I finally passed my driver's test and was allowed to go out and run as fast as I wanted to and use all of the racetrack I wanted to, oh boy, I got out there and I'm coming off of the second turn down the backstretch, and Eddie Sachs went by me like I was painted on the fence. And I thought, what in the hell am I doing here? You know, because, wow, if I felt like I had finally arrived and passed my test and was ready to go out and go fast, and one of the veterans goes by me like that, whoa, you know, is that what it's really all about?
Rutherford switched to another car and found enough speed to make the race.
The one thing that impressed me the most about that rolling away from the starting line race morning was, my God, look at all the people. The place didn't even look the same. I've been practicing there all month.
He was out after 43 laps. Johnny returned away in 1964 and barely escaped tragedy in the accident that killed Dave McDonald, and Eddie Sachs.
Eddie's car, when it impacted, reared up in the back. The nose of my roadster went under his right rear tire. I had a tire mark, a tread mark, up the nose of my car where I made contact with Eddie, and then and just under his tire and hit the back of hit McDonald's left rear tire and rode up on top of it, and I made tire marks on top of the wall there coming out of turn four. Eddie Sachs had a lemon that he cut the top out of and punched a string through and tied a knot and made a loop and made a necklace with this lemon that he hung around his neck to be able to squeeze, you know, get some relief from the dry mouth that you get sometimes. When we got my car back to the garage, Herb Porter raised the hood on the thing, and laying beside the engine in the underpans was the lemon on the string. That's getting pretty close.
With another brief race in 1965, Johnny Rutherford's Indy career went slowly. However, he continued to dominate in sprint cars, winning the 1965 National Championship. But his racing would come to a complete standstill in April of 1966. Driving a sprint car in Rossburg, Ohio, Johnny Rutherford crashed, suffering injuries that would sideline him for nearly a year.
I took a hit with something between the eyes. It knocked me out. It was big enough to knock me out. I relaxed on the throttle. The car hooked a rut at the same instant. Did a reverse, kind of a hit, bounced up and came down then on the left rear and started flipping quite violently and up on the guardrail and out of the racetrack. The pictures made Life magazine. I had a severe concussion and two broken arms and two broken little fingers.
Though he would return to Indy in 67, Johnny Rutherford did not completely return until 1970, when he joined Patrick Racing. In his first year with Pat Patrick, Johnny nearly had the pole, but was edged out by Al Unser. Starting second, Rutherford beat Unser into the first turn, but was quickly passed. Miles, Unser and Rutherford ran 1-2. But on his first pit stop, Rutherford stalled. He was forced to play catch-up and was running in the top 10 when mechanical troubles forced him out. Johnny spent two more years with Patrick Racing before switching to the McLaren team in 1973.
That was probably the best team I've ever driven for. Totally. I had always said that if I could ever find a team that wanted to go racing as badly as I did, and to work as hard at trying to accomplish, that I would be a winner. And it happened that with McLaren, it was just like magic.
The combination worked so well that Lones JR grabbed the pole and nearly became the first to pass the 200-mile-an-hour mark with an official lap of 199.071 miles an hour.
First time I had ever run flat-footed all the way around a racetrack without lifting. And the car was very, very good, very stiff. Bobbled a little bit in turn one on one of the laps, or it might have been a 200-mile-an-hour lap.
In a race filled with rain delays, accidents, and tragedy, Johnny Rutherford was slowed by mechanical problems. Still, he finished ninth. His day was coming. In 1974, the nation suffering through difficult times. The economy was down and energy was limited, forcing the Speedway management to cut qualifications from 4 days to two. Both days were slowed because of rain, and Johnny Rutherford struggled with engine problems that forced him out of the first session. On the second day, Rutherford turned the second fastest qualifying time of the year, but because of the rules, he was placed in the ninth row.
Ninth row, 25th starting spot. Good hike to the front, but I had the best handling car at the racetrack. I don't care what anybody else in the field that day says. I had the best handling car on the racetrack.
By the 12th lap, JR was in third place, and soon he was battling with pole sitter A.J. Foyt for the lead. The two Texans would dominate. At 100 laps, A.J. was in the lead. Two laps later, he dropped out.
Something happened in his engine, and he started leaking oil. And I was running very close behind him when it started, and my windshield just suddenly went black. So much oil on my car, in fact, that when I pulled in after the race and into victory lane and stopped, it left a mark. The oil dripped off of the car onto the carpet and left the shape of my car on the carpet. It was really a lot of oil, and it would have been one tremendous duel had he not had his engine oil leak.
With his main competition out of the way, Johnny Rutherford led all but one of the remaining laps.
I doubt that a lap went by that I didn't pray. And it, you know, has a funny way of presenting itself in that if you are behind and you are a few seconds behind that car, it looks like an eternity. You'll never pick up that time. If you are in front and someone's just a few seconds behind you, you think any second they're going to be there. So it depends on where you are on the which end. But I don't think there was one lap that didn't go by that I didn't ask for it to be a race and to finish where we were, and kept doing what I was doing to keep from getting carried away.
JR ran away from the pack to win his first Indy 500 with a 22.3-second margin. It was a popular win that helped people forget the tragic events of the year before.
The fans came over the fence in swarms. And probably the most frightening time in the whole race, because they swarmed out onto the racetrack and wanted to reach out and touch the car as you went by. And I was afraid I was going to run over somebody.
In 1975, Rutherford came close to winning his second straight 500. Starting from the seventh spot, Johnny ran with the leaders all day. Towards the end of the race, storm clouds rolled in.
We made our pit stop first. I was back out on the racetrack. Unser went a lap or two longer, and it started to rain, and he was ready for his pit stop, but because the rains came, he didn't make it, and the bottom fell. I mean, it wasn't a rain, this was a monsoon that hit the racetrack instantly.
The race was never resumed, and Bobby Unser was declared the winner with 174 laps completed.
Johnny and I have always gotten along good. We've worked not only on the racetracks together, we've worked against each other, we've done a lot of television things together. We've been good friends ever since we've met. And we both kind of came up at the same time. We both had our little ups and downs, some good years, some bad years. Johnny's just one fine spokesman for automobile racing.
Rain became a big factor in the 1976 race. This time, it would work in JR's favor. Rutherford started from the pole position, but was soon challenged by A.J. Foyt. Gordon Johncock was in the hunt as well. Reminiscent of the 74 race, Foyt and Rutherford went back and forth. And on lap 102, Rutherford was in the lead when the rains came. During the delay, Foyt's crew discovered and fixed a broken anti-roll bar. He would be ready to race when the track was dry enough to race on. The engines were fired for a possible restart.
We lit them up, and the bottom fell out again. It started raining like the cue. You know, it was the good Lord was waiting for us to fire them up so he could dump the water on us, you know, and put the fires out. Well, it rained hard enough, and it was late enough in the day that the Speedway decided that was it, and I walked into victory lane.
Rutherford became the first driver ever to walk to victory lane. And despite the rain, win number two was sweet.
The things that had not been there in 74 that were a disappointment were there in 76 because the economy was better. There, you know, more of the monetary side of it came up, and I've often wondered if it was solely because the economy was better or if it was the fact that I was a two-time winner and had established myself as just a flash in the pan one-time winner. I was capable of winning it twice.
Rutherford's career was taking off, but another Indy veteran was being phased out.
In 76, that victory was the last 500-mile victory for the Offenhauser, and that will be something that I will always cherish, is the fact that I won the last 500 on Offie.
For the next three seasons, Johnny Rutherford stuck with McLaren. During that time, he struggled at Indy, finishing last, 13th and 18th. And after the 1979 season, McLaren withdrew from the Indy circuit.
It was devastating because I'd been there for 7 years, and that's a pretty good tenure, you know, to have served with them and the best team in racing and have won 200s, finished second and won, nearly won the national championship, won a lot of races, you know, did extremely well, and then suddenly they say, gee, that's it, we're going to go back to Europe and we're not going to run here anymore, and you go, wow, what am I going to do? You know, where am I going?
His career was far from over. In 1979, car owner Jim Hall teamed up with Al Unser in a revolutionary new car, the Chaparral. Al dominated the first half of the 500 that year, dropping out on the 104th lap with gearbox trouble. Al chose to leave the team for 1980. Johnny Rutherford chose to replace him.
And I will always cherish the fact that I got to drive for Jim Hall because he was very easy to drive for. He had the knowledge of a driver, and you could communicate with him because he knew what you were saying when you told him, well, it's doing this and this, and he could read that in his driver, and he could go to the problem and solve it and get the car working and get it.
Rutherford and Hall did get it right in 1980. After capturing the pole, JR was heavily favored to win his third 500. Unser was not surprised.
I knew that whomever they hired would be strong. It wasn't a surprise when Rutherford did what he did.
Taking charge from the opening lap, Rutherford dominated. Everything seemed to be working right. Only the periods could slow him down. Sweeping to the checkered flag, Johnny Rutherford led 119 out of 200 laps. But it wasn't as easy as it looked.
It wasn't a comfortable race. I was as physically tired after that race as any of them. That was the three. That was even, you know, maybe it was the extra speed, you know, the excessive speed that the car generated, or this, you know, how you could run fast consistently, that made you, you know, a little more tense in the car to maintain control. But it was still a pretty tough race.
Though worn out from the race, Rutherford showed some true sportsmanship, stopping to give rookie Tim Richmond a ride back to the pits. That show of goodwill was typical of why Johnny is considered by many to be the official spokesman for auto racing.
I cannot ever remember him ever being discouraged. It was, he rarely lets things get him down. It's always, I mean, whatever's happened has happened, and so it's onward, and so you just keep working, and the next day is a work day, and so you keep working toward whatever goal you're trying to reach. But I've never seen him get so down that he'd say, I want to quit this. He really and truly loves it more than anything in his whole life. And I don't think that there are a lot of people who fit that.
Indy's newest three-time winner went on to dominate the championship car circuit in 1980.
I won the national championship laying in the hospital, virtually. Betty had to go receive all of the accolades and the awards. I came came home, and it took me a couple of weeks to recover because it really did land on my head. It was the only thing that saved me that landed on my head.
Rutherford stuck with Jim Hall for the next 2 years, but found the going tough. The competition was catching up. And at the end of 1982, Hall decided to get out of IndyCar racing. Johnny Rutherford was again without a team. Until Patrick Racing offered him a ride for 83. It wasn't a good year.
I was unfortunate enough to get caught in a weather condition and in a with the race car and slam into the wall in the short chute at the north end and broke my right ankle and my left foot. So I sat out the 83 race watching from the Indianapolis Speedway suite over in turn two, and that's not fun. I didn't enjoy that very much. The company was great, but I'd still rather be down there in one of the best seats in the house.
On his return to Indy in 1984, Johnny Rutherford found a new sponsor and continued his search for victory number four. Establishing himself as an expert driver and an excellent representative of the racing fraternity, Johnny Rutherford has been invited to the White House on four separate occasions.
I was so in awe of everything, I don't think I even enjoyed the evening because I was so afraid that whatever I was doing was going to be wrong. And spent my entire time watching other people to see if I was doing this they were doing. And to me, it was like meeting the king and queen. I mean, that was our king and queen. And I just, well, I'm a very patriotic person to begin with, and I love my country. So anyway, it was very much of a thrill.
Though his racing career consumes much of his time, JR has a deep appreciation of art and is a talented painter in his own right. Despite struggling early in his career, Rutherford was able to overcome serious injury, connect with a top team, and make a name for himself at Indy.
He consistently ran up front, and I think he had a way of extracting and running closer to the edge than most of these renowned edge runners. I mean, he was almost in a class by himself, I think. And he had maybe a few more accidents than a lot of guys, but he'd be plenty tough to race, and he could pull an awful lot out of the car.
It's still very exciting, you know, to go out there race morning. Obviously, having done it 25 times, 24 times, you've got a mental picture, but the thrill and the excitement is still there. It always will be. The world's greatest race. It's considerably faster, and the MO is quite a bit different now because of the way the cars react and act, but I still love it.
Johnny Rutherford is truly a legend at the Indy 500, a race for heroes.